good vibrations.
Welcome to episode 4 and the final in this series, examining the second summer of love and asking lots of pertinent questions. I'm joined again by Dom and Chris of Sheep Farm Studios and also Matt of the Occult Beatles, Conspiro Media. In this episode, lots of drugs, a bit like a night at Gatecrasher in about 1999. Examining MDMA, ecstasy, lots of the history behind it, discussing Alexander Shulgin and Leo Zeff, some of their dubious connections, of course throwbacks to the 60s, counterculture and all the LSD that was around there, Merck Pharmaceuticals, the Boston Group, the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, Timothy Leary, Grateful Dead, Hank Harrison, Nirvana's Smiley Face, Dr. Henry A. Murray and connections into the Unabomber, mentions of Avicii, mentions of George Martin of the Beatles, his connections with Richard, Jane and Peter Asher, Agent Orange, the Bhopal chemical disaster, books including The Psychedelic Experience and MDMA Solo, also the new I Feel Love book, memories of Soul to Soul back in the day, the Hacienda, Tony Wilson, connections to New Order, Afrika Bambaataa, the Paradise Garage, Soft Cell, and many other subjects. Let's get into it and wrap it all up. Episode 4. In more recent years, the electronic dance music scene has been used to push these ideas of transhumanism because of the digital electronic nature of the music. But when you look at these big festivals and the light shows and some of the imagery that's being flashed into the subconscious minds of the club goers, festival goers, and they'll be under the influence of MDMA still as well. So when you've got that cocktail of influences, who knows what going into the frequencies in the music, and all these visuals, all these signs and sigils, and consciousness-altering drugs, and all the young people are together in this communal experience, kind of undergoing all this stuff together. It just sounds like massive MKUltra-style social experiments, which I think we could probably conclude will be getting observed by certain interested parties. And that's happening on a massive scale every weekend all over the world now, and has been for decades.
I mean, are you going to go into MDMA, Matt?
Yeah, I was looking at my notes just to remind myself, because you talk about quote unquote social experiment. Where do you begin? How did MDMA, as it's known, get into the club scene? There are a number of people who are, according to mainstream history, the if you like, the history that we're given by the mainstream and what we're fed. There's a number of people that are held up as, you know, responsible, held up as being responsible for helping to spread it, from getting out of the world of it. Initially, it was within the confines of the therapy. It was being used by psychiatrists, from what I understand, in the 1970s. Psychiatrists were using it into the early 80s. And again, you've got a parallel there with LSD back in the 50s and 60s. In the 50s and 60s, before acid became this street drug in 67, late 66 into 67, and then for the rest of the 1960s, aside from it being within the confines of intelligence and the military and universities where it was being used as research, it was also being used by psychiatrists. Certainly it was being used by psychiatrists in the UK, because some years later quite a few years later, in the 2000s, 2010s, a number of psychiatric patients who've been administered with it back in the 60s in the UK and in the 50s as well, took the National Health Service to court. And I think some of them actually did get damages, because they were given this, they were going to the doctor, basically. They were going to their GP or their psychiatrist, if I'm not mistaken. They were going there with just a common ailment or some kind of hang up. Some kind of psychological tick, if you like, a fear of flying, for example, something like that. And they were administered with LSD. The doctor would say to them, try this, this will help. And it didn't. I mean, there's stories of some of these people who took the National Health Service to court in later decades who said it damaged their brains, it destroyed their lives, it just affected their lives for the rest, you know, decades afterwards. So you have that parallel there, where in the 60s you had the psychiatrists using it in therapy, quote unquote therapy. The same thing happened with MDMA in the 1970s. And there's one particular guy that should perhaps be mentioned. His name is Leo Zeff. The guy that is held up as the godfather of MDMA as we know it today is a guy by the name of Alexander Shulgin.
Sasha Shulgin. Some call him the father of MDMA, but in fact he is one of the leading researchers in entheogens, in chemicals that change our mood, our brain. Now, what I'm interested in, Sasha, is the roots of this all. I mean, you started working this as a scientist in a laboratory with modern means, but doesn't all this searching for the alternative goes back many, many, many centuries?
Well, you have to realize what I'm searching for, which is not for altering consciousness or for having fun or for enjoying this or for discovering that. I'm looking for tools that can be used for studying the mind. And other people then will use the tools in finding out the aspects of the mental process and how it ties to the brain. But my main drive is as a tool maker, making of tools, and letting other people exploit them.
Who was a research chemist, I think, and he used to work at Dow Chemical Company in the 1960s. And he got into psychedelics, into the research of psychedelics in 1960. After he took some mescaline, and after he took the mescaline, he said to himself, that's it, I am now going to dedicate my life to researching hallucinogenics. And it was sometime in the late 1960s into the early 70s that he was introduced to MDMA, at which point he'd left Dow Chemical Company, he'd become independent. And it was sometime in the late 60s, early 70s that a colleague of his introduced him to MDMA. He tried it, liked it. And it was in 1976 thereabouts that he synthesized this compound that we know as MDMA. In turn, he then introduced it to this guy called Leo Zeff. Incidentally, Alexander Shulgin is a member of Bohemian Grove, or was a member of Bohemian Grove. He also was given a license by the DEA. He was given a license by them in the 1960s. He was effectively given carte blanche to go about his independent research. And he was actually friends with the DEA. So for a period of about 30 odd years, from the 1960s, when he was given this license, through until the 1990s, he was never arrested. He was coming up with, there's one particular substance he came up with, which was called STP. Okay. STP was like a stronger version of acid. And he developed this whilst he was working at Dow Chemical Company. And and somehow it seeped into the 60s counterculture scene. So here we have a guy, Shulgin, coming up with these different hallucinogenics. He comes up with this STP at Dow Chemical Company, and it somehow seeps into the 60s counterculture scene of America, predominantly in 67. And it was called a nasty drug. To use one quote for it, it was called a nasty drug. And I've got a quote here, actually, from George Harrison. And this is from the anthology documentary series, which is one of the official Beatles sanctioned documentaries. And this is what George Harrison said about STP. People were making concoctions that were really wicked, 10 times stronger than LSD. STP was one. It took its name from the fuel additive used in Indy car racing. Mama Cass Elliot phoned us up and said, watch out, there's this new one going around called STP. I never took it. That's what George Harrison says. I never took it. They concocted weird mixtures back then, and the people in Haight-Ashbury got really fucked up. It made me realise that this is not it. And that's when I really went for the meditation. So that's what George Harrison said about this STP, which somehow managed to seep into the 60s scene. So here's Alexander Shulgin. He's friends with the DEA. He's been given this license by the DEA to effectively go about his research. And in fact, in 1981, when he was married, and this is according to Alexander Shulgin himself in an interview, when he got married in his back garden in 1981, the man who gave him away was from the DEA, was a personal friend of his. So that's Alexander Shulgin. Now, what happened was Shulgin in 1980, he introduced MDMA to a psychiatrist friend of his, a colleague of his by the name Leo Zeff, who was retired at the time. He tried the MDMA, loved it, came out of retirement, and over the next 4 or 5 years, he went around the US. He traveled around the US and also parts of Europe, and quote unquote, initiated his colleagues in the psychiatric community to introduce MDMA into their practices and to administer it to their patients. And he's called the Johnny Appleseed of MDMA. I think it's Alexander Shulgin, actually, who came up with that name for him. When he died, when Zeff died, his daughter was asked, how many people do you think your father initiated into, how many of the psychiatrists that he went around the world to see did he initiate into using MDMA in their practices? And she said something between 4,000 or 5,000. Now, I reckon it's probably more than that. But even if it is 4,000 or 5,000, think of that, 4,000 or 5,000multiplied by the amount of patients that each of those 4,000 or 5,000 administered MDMA to during the early 1980s. Okay, so that's Leo Zeff. And I'm trying to find a quote here. I'm trying to find my notes because there's a biography that came out, an official biography that came out about Leo Zeff. There's a very interesting quote in there from Shulgin. Basically, the book features interviews with Zeff.
And drowning in notes there.
I'm drowning it here. I'll nip in.
MDMA was invented by the Merck Group, wasn't it? Which is a massive pharmaceutical company. I think they're number four or something like that. Pharmaceutical in the early 1900s.
1912, and I think it was.
1912, yeah. And they're the oldest pharmaceutical company in the world. And interestingly, George Merck was involved. This comes back again round in circle. George Merck, who was part of the Merck family, he was involved in the US War Research Service with Frank Olson and Sidney Gottlieb. So they invent MDMA, and he's now working with, he ran it. He was the head of that side of it. And then Frank Olson tries flying without an hang glider out of that top.
So I've got a quote here about Leo Zeff. This is from Alexander Shulgin, and this is the reason mainly that I'm mentioning Zeff. So this is a quote direct from Shulgin from this biography, this officially sanctioned biography. The strangest thing about Leo for many of us was the fact that as a young man, he'd been in the United States Army and loved it. He was amused by the bewilderment of so many of his friends who couldn't quite understand how a deeply committed psychedelic guide and therapist could regard past duty in the military as a productive and enjoyable experience. I thought I'd throw that in. But how did it get into clubs? Well, it was predominantly, or not predominantly, but one of the ways it got through into the clubs was thanks to this psychiatric world, this psychotherapy community. There's a group that's... They're known as the quote-unquote Boston group. I don't know about you guys. Maybe you'll have a better job at finding more about them than I have. I've certainly tried to have a look on the internet to find out more about this Boston group. I read about them in a book, and instantly my spider senses went tingling like crazy. So I went and had a look online, and I could not find a hell of a lot about them. What I did find, though, was two or three articles about them, which do raise some interesting points. Basically, the Boston group were largely a group of professors who specialized in chemistry. And they were connected to this psychotherapy world where MDMA had been used within that community in the 70s and early 80s. And I'm guessing this was sometime around the early 80s, but that's just me guessing. But what they decided to do was to introduce MDMA to the wider world, onto the street, and they chose to introduce it into New York, into clubland of New York, so onto the dance floors of New York. And from what I understand from a couple of articles I've read about this, the way they did this was they basically took this MDMA they had to drug dealers and said to the dealers, right, we want you to introduce this unheard of drug to the dance floor community. We want you to introduce this drug to the dance floors, to the clubs of New York. And a good way of selling it in order to get people's confidence is to sell it as a healthier alternative to cocaine. That was according to this article I've read. So that's what they did. And according to this article, there's a quote here from someone who's kind of connected to this Boston group, quote unquote. And one of the reasons that they wanted to do this, they wanted to introduce this drug onto the dance floors of New York, was, quote unquote, to conduct a social experiment to see what effects it would have on the dance floor. Now, what's very interesting about the Boston group is they're professors that are largely based at two, they originate from two universities, mainly, or two organizations or bodies, if you like. One of those is MIT, otherwise known as the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. And as you guys will know, MIT is it's there to basically develop, manufacture and produce defense systems, military defense, if you like, and other types of defense for the US military and intelligence services, air defense, space defense.
It's where DARPA, I'll get put all the funding into these businesses, isn't it?
Well, I immediately thought Boston Dynamics when you were saying the Boston Group.
Well, that's it. I don't know why they're called the Boston Group, because there's not really much of a Boston, a lot of Boston type things going on here. But this is what I mean. There's not a lot of information about them that I could find. But certainly there is connections to MIT. So you have to ask yourself, why are professors who are based at MIT that are interested in an organization, a body that's into producing and manufacturing missile early warning systems, biological agent warning systems, surveillance cameras, asteroid detectors. What on earth are people coming from, you know, from MIT wanting to introduce, you know, people who wanting to introduce MDMA to the club world of New York? What on earth is, what was this MIT connection? And also, when you look at MIT, you do have connections to MKUltra. And some of this, these connections to MKUltra came out in the early 2000s, if I'm not mistaken. There was some media stories that came out in the US. I'm sure of that. I've seen the reports of them. I don't know if they came out in the UK, but certainly in the US, that yes, MIT was involved in MKUltra back in the 50s and 60s. And additionally, there's a professor at MIT, a Dr. Edgar Schein, who said at the time that these reports were coming out that he himself had accepted money from the CIA to conduct research into brainwashing techniques. So he's kind of confirming this as well. And a lot of the research that he looked into brainwashing techniques, he then published in his book, Coercive Persuasion, it was called. The other organization or university, if you like, in this case, that the Boston Group is connected to is Harvard. And again, ditto, certainly there's information out there that Harvard was involved in MKUltra back in the day. So
Leary came out of, isn't it?
Exactly. That's
was
where
it Ramdas as well?
Yeah, exactly.
I think Ramdas were Stanford.
Was it Stanford, was it?
Mm. Keezy were at Stanford as well.
That's right, where he got... he got involved in MKUltra experiments along with a member of the Grateful Dead as well. That took part at Stanford back in the 60s. There are actually connections to Alexander Shulgin and the Grateful Dead as well. It's reported, according to Hank Harrison, who is or was, because he's passed away now, Hank Harrison was Courtney Love's dad. And in the 60s, he was a trained psychologist, I think, or psychiatrist. And he used to counsel people, dropouts, people who were having issues with bad trips and stuff in the 60s in the Haight-Ashbury and those areas. He, according to him, he claims that he was a counsellor. But he claims that Shulgin was to be seen backstage at Grateful Dead concerts, and it's been suggested that he was the one that actually introduced the STP. It was him, Shulgin, that introduced this STP into the counterculture, the US countercultural scene, through the Grateful Dead's contacts.
And Harrison was a road manager for the Grateful Dead.
He was.
What you do, you know, when you're a trained psychologist, you hang out as a roadie for a greased out old, stoned out old rock band, you know.
Apparently, I've read somewhere that he was their first manager as well, but I don't know how true that is. But in later years, he he was one of the people who was very vocal about his daughter. He was saying that she was responsible for Kurt Cobain's murder, so which is quite interesting. But another, just
Kurt
to mention,
Cobain who used the smiley face.
The smiley face.
The dead smiley
face.
Dead
smiley face with a dinner
yeah.
in its head.
Yeah. It's all going full circle, isn't it? So, yeah, there was a guy at Harvard by the name of Dr. Murray, Dr. Henry A. Murray. And during the Second World War, he worked for the OSS, which is the precursor, of course, of the CIA, as it became after the war. And he was involved in experiments which it's rumoured were MKUltra, but it's never been proved. But it's been said that were MKUltra that were going on at Harvard, and they were going on between, it was a three-year experiment, 1959 to 62, and it was called Multiform Assessments of Personality Development Among Gifted College Men. Basically what these experiments were, so I understand, so we're told, is they were based on, part of it was a mock interrogation. So these were volunteers, students at Harvard took part in these experiments where they were hooked up to electrodes. They had bright lights shone into their faces. They were worn down psychologically, so their belief systems were attacked on a daily basis, that kind of thing. Do you know what I mean? And basically, the reason for these series of experiments, this three-year-long experiment, basically. According to people who were there at the time, was to see what the effects of stress are on the human brain. I mean, they call them mock interrogations, but they don't sound very mock to me. And apparently it's from these, to mention quickly, it was one of the people that was involved in these, one of the students that was involved in this as one of the human guinea pigs in these experiments was Theodore Kaczynski, who in later years was arrested for and nicknamed the Unabomber. He was arrested in the 1990s for killing three people and injuring a further 23 with a series of homemade bomb attacks between 78 and 95. He was a boy wonder. He got into Harvard when he was 16 years old on a scholarship. He was a boy genius. He takes part in these experiments with Dr. Henry A. Murray, and after the experiments, he carried on. He eventually became an associate professor, I think, at Harvard. But then in 1971, he just dropped out. He just dropped out of civilization, not just society. He dropped out of civilization. He went and lived in a wooden shack in the wilds of America. And then, yeah, and then some decades later, he becomes the Unabomber. He's arrested. So some people have suggested, or indeed many people have suggested, that these experiments might have had something to do with it. The reason I'm mentioning Dr. Henry A. Moore is because whilst he was working on these experiments between 1959 and 62, or whenever it was in 1960 that Timothy Leary went to work there as well at Harvard. And he was working on the effects of psilocybin, to see what the effects of psilocybin were on the human brain. And apparently one of his one of those who approved of his experiments and who gave him his blessing was Dr. Henry A. Murray. And there's a quote here, which is taken from Leary's autobiography. And I quote, "Murray was the wizard of personality assessment who, as OSS chief psychologist, had monitored military experiments on brainwashing and sodium amytale interrogation. Murray expressed great interest in our drug research project and offered his support."
Very good.
And to bring it full cycle, to bring it into conclusion, the Boston Group, according to one of the articles I read about them, the Boston Group were, quote unquote, colleagues and friends of Timothy Leary. Okay, so I'll leave it there.
It's interesting, isn't it, how, and I think going back in, how some of that research there is quite rudimentary. If you spin it forward to the modern DJ musician, how they'll have finessed the way that they're mind-controlling people. Whereas you can see the elements there, can't you? Whereas in the modern DJs, you wouldn't... Who's the guy that killed himself in Australia a few years ago, the DJ? He became famous. Mark wrote about him in his book. I've forgotten his name now.
Not Avicii.
Avicii, yeah, yeah. Was it Australia?
No, that was in Amman.
Amman. Anyway, these people won't even know because they'll be doing it remotely. They'll have got it programming that finessed. They won't even be anywhere near him, probably.
Well, there's not a lot of information actually about MDMA and its use in mind control, you know, its use in the military and intelligence and MK Ultra. But there is information out there. But like with LSD, we know now that it's undeniable because there are freedom of information requests that have been made over the decades. We've seen the documentation. It's all there. It's a fact. We don't know all the facts, obviously. I don't think we know all the facts, but they are there. It's not quite the same with MDMA, but there is information. If you do look around, you can find little tidbits of sort of pockets of information where, yes, it would appear that MDMA was used by the military and intelligence.
I would say that the mind control part of MDMA would be the feminization or demasculization of men, because it's certainly, and I read articles where they were saying that football hooliganism dropped, et cetera, and people were on a different trip, if you like. It weren't like acid.
Everyone got loved up.
Everyone got loved up. And so it changed the whole male society, which is where we're at now, aren't we, in essence? One quick thing. You mentioned the Beatles, and I don't know if you know this. You guys look into the Beatles more than I do, and I came across it quite by chance in my Huxley stuff. It concerns George Martin. When he left the army in whatever, it was just after World War II, and he got a handout to go to university, he was a musician who were into Rachmaninoff, Ravel, and Cole Porter. And he was taught by a lady called Margaret Augusta Elliott. Do you know? This, don't you? Who was Peter Asher's wife. The fifth Beatle was taught. What? I mean, how much of that can be?
I know. It's absolute. Again, it's like,
And do you know who she is? Right. Do you know who she actually is? She's
Related to T.S. Eliot.
Well, not just that, but her brother was the Earl of Saint-Germain.
That's fine.
And she's related to the Marquess of Stafford, the Earls of Gower, the Duke of Kingston upon Hull, Earls of Denbigh, Marquess of Dorchester.
George Martin was taught oboe by Margaret Asher years before he ever met the Beatles. And then not only does he produce the Beatles years later, but Paul McCartney goes out with Margaret's daughter, Jane, and also goes into and gives financial support to brother Peter Asher's Indica Bookshop and Gallery, which effectively was the basis of what started the UK counterculture, because that was the place where all the countercultural figures in London, the real movers and shakers, would meet and organise and all the rest of it.
Which is not different from the Palumbo story, is it?
Ministry
of Science. Is that where John Lennon met Yoko Ono? I've made that up.
Apparently, but that has been disputed. Right. That has been disputed.
But even then, the story's out there for some reason.
The story's out there,
I found a document about Dr. Asher as well. I know Mark's mentioned it, I know you have, about him being into hypnosis that was published on...
hypnosis.
Yeah, they were published on PubMed. Have you seen that document? That is just MK Ultra.
Yeah, I have to paraphrase one of the quotes in it. I have used hypnosis on my own patients, and he actually says that.
The father of Sid Barrett out of Pink Floyd was into similar research as well. Yeah. Cambridge University.
Odd.
Well, with regards to MDMA, I've got Shulgin himself here, who said in an interview that in 1950 or thereabouts, MDMA, and this is according to Shulgin, so this is a guy who's well in because he was in with the DEA and et cetera, Bohemian Grove. According to Shulgin himself, in 1950 or thereabouts, MDMA was being used in experiments by, to quote Shulgin, chemical warfare people at the University of Michigan in the US and to quote Shulgin again, possible toxin and stimulant. There's also a couple of articles you can find online, which, aside from what Shulgin has said, there's one article that's been authored by Professor of Psychiatry Torsten Passy, I think his name is, and Dr. Udo Benzenhofer. Again, apologies for my pronunciations there. Now, in this article, it informs us that the US Army experimented with MDMA between 1953 to 54 on guinea pigs, rats, mice, pigs, monkeys and dogs. Not humans, or so we're told. And there's another article out there that you can find online, which is authored by pathologist Stephen B. Karch, K-A-R-C-H. And in that article, he informs us that aside from the animal testing that I just mentioned that was cited by Passy and Benzenhofer. Separate to that, from the 1950s to the 1960s, the US Army experimented with MDMA in MKUltra. They indeed did do that, hoping that it would, quote unquote, according to the document I read on this, hoping that it could, quote unquote, succeed in weaponizing MDMA.
That reminds me, I don't know if you've heard of, I mentioned it before, Operation Cauldron, and the spin-off operations that were run during World War II. There were hundreds of different operations where in America and Britain, and I presume across Europe, where planes were flying over and basically dropping zinc, cadmium, and other apparently bacteria, but like anthrax-type bacteria, across the length and breadth of Britain. We're even driving up motorways and spewing it out of trucks and spraying it from, I think it was Dorset Coast, on a 10-mile radius. They released it into the London Underground in the 60s. Now,
yeah, I read about that, yeah.
Was it zinc cadmium?
I think so, yeah.
No, what I mean is this where they're releasing LSD, MDMA? Is this how they're doing it? I mean, this operation went until the late 80s, so to say, and it stopped.
They'd never do that now, spraying stuff. Never.
No, they won't do that now, mate. No, no.
That was what the evangelists wanted to do, isn't it? The acid evangelists in the 1960s. They seriously, and this wasn't like this wasn't stoned talk on a 3 o'clock in the morning. They were seriously thinking, hey, man, wouldn't it be great if we could just like dose the London River, the Thames, with loads of LSD, and then we'll turn on the whole world, and then they'll just like wake up and be loving and all the rest of it. This is the sort of thinking.
Like a plot from a Batman film, isn't it?
with regards to Shulgin and Dow Chemical Company, where he worked up until 65, 66, Dow Chemical Company was responsible for producing and manufacturing both napalm and Agent Orange during the Vietnam War as well. So, you know, thought I'd throw that in there.
Yeah, and obviously they were part of the pesticide release in India. In the night, well, they own the company now, in fairness to them. But I don't think anybody's been repatriated for the Bhopal disaster. Mm-hmm. Ironically, I've told Krishna this, 1984 December, I had a dream the night before that happened. And I would explain to a mate, I had this weird dream on the bus to school. And I would basically explain the Bhopal disaster. And he looked at me really weird. He went, you do know that were on news this morning, don't you?
I had the same experience with John Lennon when he got shot.
Right.
The night before, I had a dream that John Lennon had died.
Right. Yeah, it's my first and only vivid dream like that, and last one. But anyway, I dreamt about the Bhopal disaster. Weird. Anyway,
you tuned in to the universe.
It's just something, anyway.
Matt, from what you were saying earlier, MDMA ecstasy was clearly in the clubs in America in the 80s, long before it got to Britain. So we get this story about the four young lads going to Ibiza, taking ecstasy for the first time, bringing it back to Britain, and we're told that that's how it got into the clubs here. But it was already a thing in the 80s. It was part of the culture in US clubbing, particularly New York. And you've got a quote there from Timothy Leary, I think from 1985. So here's another throwback to the 60s, another connection between these two scenes, where he's talking about ecstasy being the drug of the 80s, right?
Fancy that, eh? Fancy that. I think it was in 1965 that Leary published the book, The Psychedelic Experience. It was either 65 or 66. I'm going to hazard a guess and say it was 65. So effectively, he published this book, co-authored it, along with Ram Dass, I think it was as well, introducing LSD to would-be wannabe users of it as to how to take it safely. How not to have a bad trip. So basically he was explaining to people that what you need to do is you need to have a nice environment before you take it. Make sure you're with people that aren't going to make you paranoid, and make sure you have a guide with you who can guide you through if you do start to get a little bit wobbly. So in some respects, the psychedelic experience book was a guidebook, if you like. And so that came out in 65 or 66. So fast forward to 1985, and here we have the so-called acid guru of the 60s, Leary. There's an article which you can find online, actually, and the title of it is XTC, the drug of the 80s. So this came out in July 1985. So this is about a year before the Chicago house scene kicked off big time. Chicago House, of course, was one of the foundation stones of what would later grow into a music genre, would grow into what we now call acid house in 1988-89.
Discovered by Pete Tong, so we're told.
Yeah. So this is a year before that. And this is before, so this is July 85. So effectively, anyone in the UK in July 85, the likes of us guys who would have been about 15, 16 at the time, we wouldn't have known what MDMA was. Ecstasy, as he's calling it in this article. XTC, he's actually calling it, as in XTC. He's not actually calling it ecstasy. But if you think of us, we would have been 15, 16 at the time. We wouldn't have known what that was, what that drug was. So here he is introducing the world, effectively telling us in this article, there it is in the title, that ecstasy is going to be the drug of the 80s. And apparently he was introduced to ecstasy, MDMA, himself in 1978, and he tried it for the first time in 1978 when he claims he was introduced to it by a psychiatrist. Again, back to this psychiatry thing again. He was introduced it by a psychiatrist in 1978, a guy by the name of Brian, and he took it, and that was it. He was a disciple after that. So yeah, so July 1985, pretty much a year before the house music thing kicks off with Chicago House, here we have Leary telling the world that ecstasy is going to be the drug of the 1980s. Yeah,
quite serendipitous.
Yeah, yeah.
Just another coincidence.
And there are parallels with the 60s. Again, as I say, the Psychedelic Experience book, which came out in 65, 66, was effectively this manual, if you like, part manual, a guide for people to take LSD. Now, I might be wrong, but from what I've read about acid, back in the days before it became this street drug, before it got out into the US counterculture, quote unquote, and was being used kind of haphazardly in a lot of ways, I would guess, by people who were taking it at concerts, you know, strobe lighting, you know, like hedonistic kind of atmosphere. Before that occurred, before it was a street drug and it went that way, from what I understand, people who used to take LSD, aside from it being used within the intelligence circles, that this secret world, these so-called quote unquote intellectuals that were taking it, the way to take it was within a sober environment. So as this guidebook, the Psychedelic Experience, guides the user to do, it was to be used in a sober environment. So it wasn't about hedonism. It was about sitting in a room, relaxed atmosphere, maybe dim the lights a little bit, be with like-minded people, calm, collected, like-minded people who aren't going to freak you out. No freaky things going on, you know, no like scenes going on, like fights or whatever else might be going on if you were to be in a hedonistic atmosphere, like a concert or whatever. And then, yeah, then it seeped out into the so-called US counterculture and the so-called UK counterculture. And it became, yeah, and it wasn't being used in a responsible way. It was being used more like a party drug as opposed to a relaxation kind of thing, you know? So it's like it was, yeah, it's kind of, yeah, yeah, like it was planned. It wasn't meant, the drug is not meant to be used in that way. I was just going to say that MDMA, the same thing happened with MDMA in the 1970s. That was what MDMA was being used as. It was being used in an environment, from what I understand, within the so-called world of the quote-unquote intellectuals. It was used in a sober environment. Again, a sober environment. It wasn't meant to be a hedonistic drug. It wasn't meant to be used with pulsating rhythms and lights flashing in your face at the same time. It was meant to be taken in the privacy of your own home, in a warm environment with like-minded, cool, calm, collected people. Okay. And then again, like the 1960s, the club scene kicks off, the ecstasy seeps into the wider world. And what do we have? We have this hedonistic thing going on again. So we have this drug which is meant to be used in a calm, collected way, being used in a hedonistic atmosphere. And again, just like the 60s, in the 70s and 80s, from what I understand, you could get manuals on how to use MDMA, which were similar to what Leary put out in the 60s. You could get guidebooks that would guide you about how to take MDMA in a comfortable surrounding. without getting freaked out by it. So again, we have this parallel world going on. And indeed, the Castalia Foundation, which is Leary's foundation, actually published a manual. I don't know when this came out. It could have come out actually after he passed away, but they actually published a manual, a guidebook on how people can use MDMA in a calm environment. So again, it's like the sequel to the psychedelic experience. And it's a book called MDMA Solo, authored by Phoenix Caspian. So yeah, again, parallels, just the thing keeps going, you know, round and round. And yeah.
And right up to present day, where there's that new book that I sent over, I Feel,
yeah,
MDMA and the Quest for Connection in a Fractured World.
Which to me sounds like, are they trying to promote it to be used within therapy legally, again, within psychotherapy in a legal context? Yeah. This has been going on.
A lot of reinforcement of the official narrative going on. I don't know if you've noticed this. Matt, it strikes me as similar to what we're getting with the Beatles. In recent years, they've just ramped up the official Wikipedia version of the Beatles with all these documentaries coming out and all these books and stuff. And when it comes to the Second Summer of Love, so-called, they seem to be reinforcing all of that as well. There's that new book you mentioned. There was a BBC Four documentary just a few years ago, How Dance Music Changed the World. And they just constantly ram this story down our throats as to how the whole thing got started. Just repeating it over and over and over again, these myths that you get. And it's almost as if they're desperate to get this new generation believing the story of where this music and this culture came from.
So, as we did the 60s stuff.
Exactly.
At the time when we were growing up.
Yeah.
Same thing. Just and again, just like we've repeated it over and over and over again.
Like we were talking about, I think in the last one, and I know Crow's mentioned it, where people have this emotional connection. So when you hear people, some of the comments that we got when I released it on our YouTube channel, 99.9% of them were positive. And we did a Doors podcast as well. And obviously you get people who support the Doors, you know, and they can't disconnect from that. Even if they're into some sort of truth side of it, they still can't disconnect from that. It's still an important part of their world. And it is difficult to disconnect from it, isn't it?
It is. I mean, personally, I enjoyed it. I now look back on those days, 88, 89, 90, and I live on the East Coast. So for me, going to London, just a couple of hours drive away, I used to go to Camden Town on a Sunday, every Sunday. I used to go to the Soul to Soul shop. I met Jazzy B there as well, had a chat with him. There was just this, there was the Electric Ballroom. There was Red or Dead, which had just started up in the shop. Yeah. And there was a record shop that was there that I used to get my dance imports from.
I went to London. I went to the Soul to Soul shop because I love Soul to Soul. And I bought a t-shirt. I'm guessing I was 16, 17. And I just didn't take it off. Do you remember it?
The funky dread. Yeah, I bought that one, not the sweatshirt version. Yeah. So, and I look, and even now I look back on those days and I look back at them with warm affection.
They were our days, weren't they?
I loved it. I loved it. I absolutely loved it. And it's not rose-tinted spectacles because I loved it at the time. You know, I just used to go to London every weekend just to soak some of that in, you know.
I was going
to
say as well, Matt, just going back to what you said about acid. I did acid when I was, like I said, I wanted to be part of that scene. And I mean, how did my mates get hold of acid in 1980s Huddersfield? Where the heck did they get it from?
You could get it.
Yeah, but I just mean, again, where did the manufacturing of it come from?
Yeah.
To get it into a little town in West Yorkshire.
You're talking of industrial-sized manufacturing to get it around the world and into towns in areas.
But going back to what Matt was saying, I remember we did it on the streets because we were too young to go to clubs. So I'm guessing I was 15 or 16, which is very scarily young for a kid to be doing acid on the streets.
That is.
By the way, we live in the sticks. We live in a small village in the top of the Yorkshire Pennines as well. So
it was probably escapism from Dom, to be fair, thinking about
probably.
It. But, but then I remember going
He wasn't your guide then?
No, definitely not. I remember going from the streets doing it with my mates, which was quite good fun and it is quite a relaxed experience if you're in that environment. But then I remember doing it in a club and I just got freaked out.
Right, because I was going to ask you what
it literally filled with water in front of my eyes, and then fish turned up. And I remember saying to my mate, "Can you see some fish in here?" And he's like, "What are you on about? You yeah." And I was like, "I got to get out of here," and I couldn't get out of there. I was just trapped in there for. So it wasn't, that wasn't a nice experience. It was interesting, but it wasn't particularly nice.
But I mean, the place I went to, obviously, was the main, got me really into the dance scene because I was a soul boy, was that the Hacienda. And again, I start scratching around at the Hacienda, and lo and behold, somebody sends me an email, and you realize that our friend Tony Wilson of Factory Records, he had connections with a French philosopher called Guy Debord. And Yorkshire and French don't really go together, but there you go. He wrote a book called The Society of the Spectacle. And the Spectacle was an even bigger organization. When you dig below that, it's quite a lot of psychologists and things like that from
situationists
from the Frankfurt School.
Wasn't Wilson wanting to do with New World?
New Order.
New Order.
New Order.
Yeah.
New
Happy Order. Mondays. Yeah.
That was a drift towards the beginning of electronic dance music, I would say. Yeah. New
that
Order.
That's what was known as Madchester back in the
Madchester.
Day. Yeah.
But New Order, I nearly said New World Order then.
Doing too much research.
I think the statement was the Hacienda does not exist. The Hacienda must be built. That was in his book. And so
they mentioned that in that BBC 4 documentary of a few years ago, How Dance Music Changed the World. They mentioned Tony Wilson, and they actually give that quote, that piece of poetry, whatever it was, about the Hacienda.
Yeah. And this Guy Debord, one of his colleagues, was linked to the CIA. So now he's a Guy Debord was a French philosopher, etc. And one of his colleagues was linked with the CIA. So again, we're getting back into that world where you've got Tony Wilson looking, it's organic, he's set this Hacienda up, and the people who is utilizing is basically CIA. And it also, I think he followed the early research, or Debord followed the early research from Bernays and Adorno, among others.
So Tony Wilson was a situationist, and also Malcolm McLaren and Bernie Rhodes, who were the managers of the Sex Pistols and The Clash, respectively. So quite the coincidence that the managers of these influential bands, and with Wilson, you've got Joy Division, who became New Order, all happened to be into this same sort of intellectual anarchist movement.
I'm starting to think that possibly the punk movement could have been contrived as well.
That's the next series.
I mean, that's been blatantly contrived, isn't it?
Yeah, it was, yeah.
A lot of that was based on situationism, from what I understand. Yeah, Malcolm McLaren, again, 60s parallels. You've got Malcolm McLaren, whose roots, I think, go back to, well, they go back further, but I'm sure he's linked in some way, shape or form to a 60s movement, if you like, a group, if you like, late 60s movement, who around in the UK countercultural scenes, in the underground scene in the late 60s, by the name of King Mob. They were called King Mob. They weren't really hippies. They were pretty much, they were kind of like anti-hippie, if you like. They weren't into wearing flowers in their hair and all of that kind of jazz. But if you look at King Mob, then you see a trail. Malcolm McLaren was basically in that scene in the late 1960s, if I'm not wrong. So again, you have this link going back to the late 60s underground scene of London, linking to punk and linking then to Manchester, Tony Wilson, Hacienda, Factory Records, which was his label, and the whole baggy scene, the Manchester scene with New Order and the Happy Mondays.
Three movements that came ready with dress sense and everything, all ready to go, all the clubs ready to go.
McLaren links into hip-hop culture due to his affiliation with Afrika Bambaataa. He did some records with him. Johnny Rotten, John Lydon made a record with Bambaataa, who's since been exposed or accused of being a predatory paedophile. So there's another movement there, this nascent sort of hip-hop culture coming out of New York. McLaren had a part in those early days as well. So,
and I hear a story, I don't know how if anyone knows any more about this, New Order, when they first went to America in the early 80s, and this might have been around the time that they released the track Blue Monday, so this would have been about 1983, 82. They got introduced to ecstasy when they went to America. They would go around the clubs.
Went
and that's
Paradise
when they
Garage,
got
didn't they?
Was that where it was? So yeah, I'm wondering, did they bring ecstasy back to the UK at that point?
Well, the Hacienda was apparently fashioned on the Paradise Garage out in New York.
Okay.
Because they went out there and had this trip. What does that remind you of? bunch of young lads go abroad, go to a club, have this amazing experience, try to recreate the vibe back in the UK. And that was the Manchester version of it. The Hacienda was modeled on what they'd experienced in New York.
I'm just wondering whether New Order went over there, got introduced to this new wonder drug on the dance floors that was helped to be spread out there by groups like the Boston Group, whoever they are. And I'm just wondering whether the New Order brought some back with them and helped to distribute it, get it introduced into the scene in Britain. I don't know. I'm just
That's 5 years before Oakenfold and them.
Yeah, yeah. And this, I've also read stories about Soft Cell before they released their first album in 1980, 81. They went to America and they were mixing in the gay club scene of America and they got introduced to ecstasy. And then they came back to Britain, of course, and recorded their first album. And they got introduced to ecstasy while they were over there. So I don't know if they had anything to do with the early promotion of ecstasy into the clubs of the UK before it went really mainstream in 88, 89, and everyone,
would have missed taking it. That scene in the gay scene, wouldn't it?
That's yeah. So I'm just wondering whether people like New Order and Soft Cell came back from America with bags of it themselves and started to say, hey guys, have you tried this? And then it kind of starts very sort of modestly in that kind of environment and then it grows, doesn't it? So I don't know if they had anything to do with that. I don't know. I'm just throwing it out there,
Wouldn't be beyond the realms of possibility, would it?
Yeah. For sure.
Well, it all seems very orchestrated.
Which seems to be the overall theme of these shows. So I wonder if in one generation's time, there's going to be a whole bunch of young researchers that look back on this scene in the same way that we're looking back on the 60s, and it's going to get exposed to the extreme. Whereas right now, we're sort of one generation on, and we seem to be the only guys out there asking these sort of questions about what happened in the 80s. And I wonder if people are going to be looking back on life in the 2020s, in generations to come, and saying, oh, Cardi B and Megan Thee Stallion were great, weren't they? I miss those days. Those were wonderful times.
I've always wondered, I don't know if I'm seeing it wrong, but if you look to pop culture, if you like, 1957, you had rock and roll, you had the Teddy Boys, okay? And I'm looking again at this from a British perspective. I'm not looking at this from the US perspective. So 1957, it's all in sevens or thereabouts. 1957, you've got rock and roll, Teddy Boys. Teddy Boys. 1967, you've got the so-called Summer of Love, hippies. '77, you're on the sort of the cusp of you're in the throes of punk, a new wave, so punk. '87, house music. And then a year later, you've got acid house, and then that's it. Nothing else after that. 97, nothing. 2007, nothing.
No scenes anymore, is there?
Yeah.
The grunge stuff, didn't you? And you had mods and things like that.
Yeah,
and
all they weren't culture defining on a mass scale, were they?
No, they weren't. You got the Northern Soul, small bits, aren't they? Small bites.
Yeah, yeah.
Did they do it on the seven, getting it lined up for the next decade? I would say, I guess.
Yeah, maybe.
Just 3 years before, and then that, because the 90s were the real dance music period, weren't it? Weren't the late 80s? When it was really established, was the 90s, like Ministry of Sound.
Can you remember that program?
Setting up the decade almost.
Remember that program? What was that called? 7 years or something like that? Where
Seven Up.
Seven Up. And then kids were, and they followed them all through the life. So
from the age of seven onwards.
From the age of seven upwards, yeah.
Nothing creepy about that.
No, nothing at all.
So what would you describe the culture we've got now? Music and fashion and stuff?
Bland.
I work with some youngsters and I heard one of them, like you were saying, will someone look back at this period and analyse the music? Because it's pretty much more blatant, I would say, wouldn't you? With the symbology and
the orchestration. I mean, yeah. You just mentioned that Cardi B. I heard someone listening to her at work. God, it's just, I mean, I do sound like an old man saying it, but it's just vulgar, isn't it? It's just vulgar.
It's bland. That's what swearing, I find about pop, that chart music. It's bland. It's so, there's nothing that there.
What's that just mumbly rap that they do where there's just some guy saying how miserable he is and his life's awful? Oh, God. Do you know what the hell is that? It's awful. But I do sound like an old bloke saying that.
Yeah. Four old bastards. We will wrap up these episodes here then, guys. Any parting thoughts before we go, based on everything we've discussed over these four episodes? Because I feel this has been quite a groundbreaking series, because we've been asking questions that nobody else has, to my thinking. So, should we sign off?
Yeah, again, we're just witnessing the blue bloods directing us pros, whether we like it or not. But like Matt said, I enjoyed the 90s and the late 80s, so I'm not going to bitch about it. But you have to realise that we've been, it's all contrived, and we've all been controlled by it.
We've been had.
Again. I mean, I think Crow and Jason did a series where everything stopped at 2000, didn't they? And nothing's really started after that. And you can certainly see the line, you know, especially 9/11. Yeah, after that it was a, but certain things happened, didn't there, like 9/11, obviously, like the nonsense we've lived through has woke a lot of people up. So there are certain things happening that they're the timelines as well, aren't they? JFK, Princess Diana, 9/11, all these things that happen that people stop and think, where were I when that happened, you know? There's a lot of those happening over the last 20 years.
I'm certainly seeing a lot of people who I wouldn't have ever imagined would, to use a term I don't really want to use, but wake up. Yeah. People that I never thought would, in recent times, in the last couple of years or so, actually, waking up. And it's and they walk up to me and say, oh, did you know that the World Health Organization, blah, 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 blah. And I'm thinking, my God, is this the same person talking to me that I knew 5 years ago? My God, mate, what's happened? This is brilliant.
And you're like, yeah, I told you about it.
And you laughed at me. I would just conclude by saying, yeah, the same thing again, that it's like a proviso, if you like, you know. As much as we're questioning what happened back then or didn't happen, I enjoyed it at the time, so I just want people to know that you know, I'm not, you know, I don't want to slag the whole thing off. I just want to make sure that people realise and understand that, yeah, we're questioning it, but I enjoyed it at the same time.
I loved it. Chris loved it. Matt loved it. We all did. But as soon as you start digging, you realise that there's some sort of construct going on, because there's too much control and money involved.
You can't have a scene that is as wide-ranging and influential as this without it being controlled, because the social engineers would just not allow it.
No. Even if it did start off organic, and I'm sure some stuff do start off, they wouldn't, and it got popular, they would not allow that to get that popular.
Without hijacking it.
Yeah.
So, Tavistock social engineers, what you got for us next? We'll know soon enough.
Not for us old bastards, anyway. For the youngsters. Yeah.
Whatever it is, we'll be doing a show on it. You can be sure of that.
Grandpa House. That'll be the new genre. They'll get us to Granddad House.
Yeah, Zimmer House.
Zimmer House.
Zimmer. Yeah.
All right, guys.
Thanks for coming on the show. And that concludes the series from Good Vibrations, examining the second summer of love in a way which, to my thinking, has never been done before. My big thanks go out to Dom and Chris, and also Matt, for their hugely incisive research, knowledge and memories. You can check out their respective podcasts at sheepfarm.co.uk and theoccultbeatles.wordpress.com and conspiromedia.wordpress.com. And Matt is also my co-host on the Magical Mystery Talk series examining occult aspects of the Beatles. Huge thanks also to Gregg Vardy for an amazing job on the video editing and producing this entire series. We do these shows not to piss off fans of the music, not to destroy people's nostalgic attachments or memories to the culture and the scene, but simply because we want truth. And wherever we find it, we feel the responsibility to communicate it far and wide to anyone who would care to listen. So on that note, we hope that people have found value in the information that we've presented. Of course, listeners must always make up their own minds in terms of drawing conclusions on what this information really means. There's lots more of what we've got into in these shows in my book, Musical Truth, Volume 2, part of my trilogy of books in that series. These are available on Amazon, or you can get them from me personally by dropping an email to markdevlinuk@gmail.com. Come back soon for more podcasts of this nature. Cheers. Good vibrations.